my talk is about parasites, I want to start by talking about you or people you may know. Most of us know people whom, hopefully not among those present, but around us, who may indulge in driving dangerously. People who are pugnacious, always looking for a fight. People with schizophrenia, or women who endure the sad experience of miscarriage early in pregnancy. What do you think causes these issues? Genetics? Mental health? Even among highly educated professionals, I would wager parasites will be the last thought on people's mind. What if I told you there is a single parasite species that can cause all these and even more issues, and the parasite is common among estimated one-third of the world population? You may think, oh, but parasites are a problem of people with poor hygiene, living in developing countries, and among lower socioeconomic backgrounds. But in Australia alone, the infection rate estimated to be higher than world average, infecting 40% of Australians, and it's actually more common among people who are affluent enough to have a pet cat or consume red meat regularly. What parasite is this? Scientists call it Toxoplasma gondii, but don't panic, I'm just going to simply call it Tom. Let's get to know Tom together. Tom actually is a very invisible and very tiny parasite, completely invisible to our eyes. It happily lives inside cats' intestine and rarely causes any sickness in cats. Why would he? Cat intestine is Tom's entire world. It is where he spends his childhood. He grows, he finds a partner. And he actually is such a family lover that produces millions of offsprings every single day. Like humans, Tom's children eventually leave their home, cat's intestine, and I leave it to your imagination as how exactly that happens, and spread into the world, into the environment, trying to find a new home, another cat. Inevitably, some of these very tiny children in this big, wide world get lost, and they may end up in our bodies or in the flesh of animals we eat. When we do not wash our hands before our meals or when we consume raw or undercooked meat products, we can become home to some of these lost children. And what is remarkable is that these guys multiply in our bodies and generate hundreds and thousands of clones. Basically, if you think about it, turning our body into a massive free childcare for Tom's children without us even realizing it. Now, the health impact depends on whereabouts in our body they lodge. In our brain, they change the way we think, behave, and react. For example, women who host these guys may flirt more, while men may become angrier and more prone to aggression. Research also shows infection with this parasite can increase suicidal thoughts. Dangerous behaviors such as speeding while driving, and even mental health issues. In other parts of the body, the parasites cause other problems, such as miscarriage, blindness, and even a stroke. Now, I said about one-third of the world population are infected with this parasite. How likely is it that our health professional will consider this parasite when we suffer from a stroke or when we have mental health issues? Will the police officer believe that Tom's children are the reason for your speeding? Now, let's move on from Tom, because human health aspects are not the only reason that parasites are important. I want you to think about this environment, about planet Earth. Did you know that parasitic species outnumber all other species, plants, animals, and humans combined? Parasites dominate the world purely through weight of numbers. This beautiful world, as we know it, would not be the same if we get rid of all parasites. If we care about our planet Earth and our environment, it is important for us to recognize we live in the world of parasites, not they in ours. And you may think I'm crazy and strange, but let me explain myself a little bit better. In a healthy environment, free from human interventions, there is a delicate balance between parasite populations and their host. Because at the end of the day, parasites need their host to survive. Without them, they will die. In most instances, it is us humans that disturb this delicate balance and turning parasites into monsters by ignoring their impact. And a relevant example is happening right now, very close to this venue. I'm giving this talk from Wiradjuri country in Australia, which has been home to the Murray-Darling Basin and its vast water system. It also has been in crisis for a very long time. Decision makers have allocated millions of dollars towards managing this unfolding drama, yet in reports produced, a critical oversight exists. Absence of consideration of parasites, which constitute more than 50% of basin's biodiversity. And that demands our immediate attention. To understand this better, let me introduce you to two other parasitic individuals, which scientists call them Lernia cyprinacea, but I'm going to call them Romeo and Juliet. Like Tom, Romeo and Juliet came to Australia after colonization, and most likely with carp. In their childhood, Romeo and Juliet just play and swim in the water. And the more agricultural fertilizers in our waters, the happier they are. As teenagers, they try to find a new home, which for them is going to be a fish. So they have to attach to a fish. But it's not an easy task for this tiny couple to board a fish because a healthy fish is always moving and swimming, and the water around fish is also flowing. For us humans, it would be as mounting a galloping horse. For Romeo and Juliet, to board a fish, both fish and the water have to be still and not moving at all. In other words, environment must be in disastrous condition. And our research at CSU shows that many fish in the Murray-Darling basins, unfortunately, are home to many Romeos and Juliet. Let's move on. After Romeo and Juliet settle on a fish, their lives take a dramatic turn, much like famous story by Shakespeare. But this time, Romeo dies and leaves Juliet behind pregnant with hundreds of babies. Now, this soon-to-be single mother, like science fiction movies, turns into a vampire and starts to feed the blood from the fish so that she can feed all her baby vampires until they grow and leave her body. This takes a few days, and during this time, she also transmits some of her microorganisms to the fish, adding to the health issues of this already stressed fish. Now, believe it or not, there are many reports about health of the aquatic systems that rely only on presence or absence of the fish as the main indicator of the ecosystem's health. But how can you tell a fish that is present is also healthy and happy when they do not vocalize? Fish do not express sadness, express sickness and pain like we humans do by swearing and screaming. Understanding fish health and expertise in fish health requires several years of postgraduate studies and is rare in our country. No wonder in discussions about aquatic health, parasites and their impacts are often ignored. When relocations of our fragile species, especially native species, are celebrated, I wonder how much consideration has been given to the parasites in the new location that are waiting for this fragile population to arrive. Also, as a parasitologist, I know parasites could be anywhere in the body places that you can't see them, no matter how big they might be, in the brain, in eye, inside the cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, anywhere. So how many parasites get transmitted through these relocation activities to new places? I wish we would have learned from the past, but we don't. We are human, aren't we? It's a repeated behavior. Such as in human societies, that a lot of time immigrants bear the blame for issues such as job loss and so on. When it comes to our environmental management also, immigrant species such as carp bear the blame for problems caused by people's neglect and oversight. As we know, Australia has spent millions of dollars trying to introduce a deadly virus that doesn't naturally occur in Australia, trying to rapidly eliminate carp population from the system, while at the same time, several other countries are spending more money trying to control the adverse impact of the exact same virus. Don't get me wrong, I'm not against the carb control. I believe carb control in Australia is essential, but I question the wisdom behind such drastic approaches. Because as a parasitologist, I know parasites like Romeo and Juliet are not picky. They do not care if it's carb or it's maricot. Cheap or chic are one and the same. When we remove all these carp rapidly from the water systems, we are leaving our native species, the precious native species, as the only target for those baby vampires and many other parasites, eggs, and children. Clearly, to make wiser decisions, we need better education. But how can we do that when, despite parasite outnumbering all other parasitic species, parasitology teaching is not part of typical education of environmental scientists? Worse, even in courses such as medicine and veterinary science that traditionally students used to learn in great details about parasites, now the amount of parasitology teaching has been significantly decreased in Australian universities. Today, I placed human at the center of importance. In the examples I gave, toxoplasma introduced as Tom infects us. Lernia introduced as Romeo and Juliet infect fish. That is important for us as a food source to our economy and for sport fishing. But it's not only Romeo, Juliet, and Tom. It's cast of thousands. Remember, parasitic species dominate the world, and they are more than non-parasitic ones. In fact, parasitic and non-parasitic species have learned to live together and evolve together for over a billion years, long before humans appear on this planet. Therefore, every ecosystem, every environment needs parasites if it's a healthy environment, and for its sustainability and for its success. For us, it is important to understand there is more to environment than we can see. And understanding this, the nature of this hidden player is very important for successful management of the environment. Parasites might be invisible, but their impacts are enormous.